Well, it's a participatory democracy kind of talk, so everyone is welcome to choose his own title. The only thing is that this is joint work with Alexandru Oancea, and I would like to thank the organizer for the invitation. Merci beaucoup. So this started with two, well, let's say it's sources. The first one is a paper by Eliasberg and Hofer. Which is called Towards the Definition of Symplectic Boundary. And which asks the following question. Well, if you're given, I will be more specific on the assumption, but a symplectic manifold. So just for a second, the symplectic manifold will be open, but such that it has a boundary. And the question is, does W omega determine sigma? So that's one, and actually, the second one is a paper by, a result, let's say, by Fleur, Duza, and Eliasberg, Yasha, about the following says that if you have M omega, which is symplectically a spherical. Yeah.
Do you mean the interior determine the
boundary? Yeah, does the interior determine the boundary? That's what I mean. So it's if M omega.
And determining the boundary means as an abstract manifold or as what?
No, as if it's a contact boundary with the contact structure, for example, or what can you say about that? With omega over pi 2 is 0, so symplectically a spherical. And if m omega is symplectomorphic to R to n with the standard symplectic form, then m is diffeomorphic to R to n.
You haven't said that correctly. You mean it's symplectomorphic to that at infinity?
At infinity, yes. I said that. I didn't write it down, but I said it.
You said it in your mind.
Well, maybe. But as I said, it's participatory democracy talk, so you're welcome to add your favorite assumptions to. Or maybe the. The necessary assumptions to the statements, and also to modify the conclusion, if you like. Then M is diffeomorphic to R to N. Actually, for n equal two, there's a stronger and older result by Gromov, which implies that M is actually symplectomorphic to R4 with the standard symplectic form. But this is very specific to four-dimensional situation, and I will not talk about that, even though what I'm going to explain could be maybe adapted in dimension 4 to get stronger results in this kind of spirit. Okay. So just one word about this. Well, first it uses moduli spaces of curves, which is the excuse for discussing these kind of problems here. And the second is that the proof is actually in two parts. One, first you prove that the homology of M is zero, and then, except in dimension zero, And then you prove that the pi 1 is actually 0, okay, which is, if I'm correct, which is what Yasha proved. Okay. So I will, again here, not be interested in pi 1 questions, even though it could be interesting to check that. So what I will, what you should remember about this theorem is that if m omega is like r to n with the standard structure at infinity, then the homology of m is like the homology of r to n. Okay. And there's a slight, slightly different way to rephrase that. Which is the following, is that if W omega, and I will again explain a little bit more about that, as contact boundary which is the sphere with the standard contact structure, then M is diffeomorphic to R to N or to the, sorry. First it's not M, it's W. And here let's say it's the same, of course, but to the unit ball. Makes it more.
But you do need omega.
With still, again, with omega over pi 2. Well, just because if you have such a manifold, you add the symplectization of the sphere, and then you get something which is, so you have your something which bounds the sphere here inside, and then you just have the symplectization, and you get some manifold which is symplectomorphic to R to N with the standard structure at infinity. Okay. So. So this is the kind of question I will be interested in. And in fact, let me just, unfortunately, we have to write down some definitions which are pretty much standard. If you have sigma xi or contact manifold, and if you have an embedding in a symplectic manifold, then this is a contact embedding if there exists some form alpha near sigma such that xi is determined by alpha, so is the kernel of alpha. And the alpha is omega, well, of course, near sigma, since that's where it's defined. And the embedding is exact, or sometimes it's said restricted contact type. If alpha extends to M, and of course, as a primitive of omega. So that's definition one. Definition two, which is basically the same, is that a symplectic filling of sigma xi is just a symplectic manifold M omega, and I will add with no closed component. Such that the boundary of W is sigma when, by slight abuse of language, I will say that sigma xi is contact embedded in W omega. Well, there's slight abuse of language because W only exists on one side of sigma, not on the other side. So it's not a usual embedding. Okay, so the existence of alpha is only on one side, but I think it's pretty pretty clear what it means.
Can you in fact always extend by some simplification?
Yeah, you can always extend by some small simplification. So there's no real. There's no issue there. And so it's exact. The filling is exact. If, again, as before, let me say. If it's exact as above. And the last thing I need is can everyone see when I write here? You can't, but it's okay. Well, it only says definition 3, so you can. And the filling of sigma xi is Stein. Well, if it's a Stein manifold, so if I have W omega, the symplectic manifold, psi is a function, so psi is J plurisubharmonic, and J times omega. Sigma is psi minus 1 of 0, and psi is negative on W. So it's W is a sublevel of plurisubharmonic. So as a consequence of being plurisubharmonic, sorry, I missed something here. And xi is j star of deep psi. Okay. So, well, sorry, the kernel, I should say. So the contact form is given by the kernel of j star of deep psi. So if you have a plurisubharmonic function, all critical points have index less or equal to n, and it's time subcritical. If and only if all critical points of psi have index strictly less than n. Okay, this is.
Are you asking for J to be integrable?
No, but no. So I will start. On one of the blackboards, okay. Let's start on this one. By something which is an elementary remark based on the Fleur-MacDuff-Eliasberg theorem. Um, So some of you may say very elementary remark, maybe. So the theorem is the following. So if sigma Xi has a contact embedding in R2N with the standard symplectic form, and interior component Z. So if you have an hypersurface in R2N, it has an inside and an outside, and the inside is called Z. Now let W omega be a symplectic filling of sigma Xi. And let's say such that the second relative homology of W with respect to sigma vanishes. Then the map from HP to W, well, let's say 1 first, to HP of sigma induced by inclusion is injective. And the second remark is that any two such fillings have the same Betti numbers. And the third remark is that the pth Betti number of sigma is the p Betti number of W plus the 2n minus p minus 1 Betti number of W. Okay. So I must say we are a little bit surprised to discover that. So it's not just the sphere, and you will see that it's totally, I mean, once I tell you it's totally elementary, you can actually prove it in two lines by yourself. Okay. But it's not just that the sphere that has a unique contact filling, in the sense, unique in the sense that the topology is completely determined by sigma, but you have a whole class here. And in fact, if you have a contact embedding of something into R2N, it's very easy to construct many more. So let's say it's very hard if you give yourself a sigma, a contact manifold, it's very hard to embed it in R2N a priori. I mean, unless it's already given as something embedded in R2N. Okay? But once you have something embedded in R2N, it's very easy to construct new ones by just doing surgery along handles of index less than, strictly less than n. Okay, you have something like this, let's say. You can start with a sphere, and then you can add a handle like this just as much as you like, provided the index is less than n.
So you're adding handles to what?
You're doing surgery, I mean. So you're adding a Lagrangian, or actually isotropic, because I say it's less than n. Some isotropic.
So you're modifying sigma.
So once you have a sigma, for example, the unit sphere, then you can construct lots of things with quite different topologies. So the only thing that is delicate to touch is the n-dimensional homology. Okay.
Can I ask about the definition of filling? You don't distinguish between sigma being convex or concave boundary.
It's always a convex boundary. I should have said that from the beginning, that all my contact structures are oriented and everything here is considered compatible with orientation. So indeed, they're all convex boundaries.
I'm a little confused about this surgery. So you have sigma as a contact hypersurface in R2L.
Yeah.
And then you're modifying.
Well, you attach a hand. You attach an isotropic handle, and make surgery on this handle. And because it's isotropic, you can just put it in any way you want without by still being embedded. This is something you can find in a paper by, an old paper by Lodenbach in the 80s.
But why is it still embedded in R2L?
Yeah.
Well, because it's embedded. I mean, you start with something embedded, you add an isotropic handle here, and basically the isotropic, but non-Lagrangian. So isotropic in dimension n minus 1 at most satisfies H principle. So you can just realize that as something embedded and not crossing again the sphere, and then you do the surgery around this.
So you're finding an isotropic submanifold of R2N, which is going to be the core of the handle.
Yeah, and you can always do that because you're in the dimension that where you have H principle. Okay.
Did Z enter into this anywhere?
Sorry?
The interior component Z.
Well, you could say that because they all have the same Betti number here from 2. You could say that the Betti numbers are the Betti number of Z, if you want.
So do you prove that the filling, you've got sigma fixed and you have HP mapping to, it's injected into HP sigma. Is the image of that determined? Is that independent of
almost.
You don't claim that quite.
Almost, except in dimension. Not in general. Let me maybe state. Yeah, before I prove that, which is. So here, how many blackboards? 2 only. Okay. Let me state a corollary. Here you probably don't see. It's great. Okay. Well. Is there a blackboard on which you can't see?
The boards that are behind that are the problem because of the thing coming up. It's not. That's the front board. That's always all right.
It's the one. The one. Okay.
The one behind.
Okay. Well, I put myself in between the board and you. So. Yeah. So the corollary is the following, is that if sigma xi has a contact embedding in the standard R2N, and W omega is a Stein filling, then, and I need, actually I forgot why, but I need n to be greater than 3. BP of sigma, so the Betti number of sigma, is the same as the Betti number of W for P between 0 and n minus 2. And B n minus 1, so n minus 1 Betti number of sigma, which is the same as the n Betti number of sigma by Poincaré duality, is the sum of Bn of W and Bn minus 1 of W. So in particular, if W is Stein subcritical, then Bn minus 1 of sigma is Bn of minus 1 of W, and Bn of sigma is Bn. No, I don't claim that.
Really.
we have Bn minus 1 sigma and Bn of sigma. So that be a plus sign between them? Maybe?
Yeah. Here?
No, on the left.
Here? Equal?
No, on the left.
On the left?
Right there.
Here? Equal? Bn minus 1 and Bn are the same because it's 2n minus 1 dimensional manifold. And you have Poincaré duality.
Oh,
that's the only.
But it's still a plus sign over there.
Here it's a plus sign. Yeah. The sum of the two. And here is an equality sign.
I think I missed the explanation as to why this elementary mark is elementary. Is the point that.
I haven't proved it is elementary yet.
You're not going to do some sort of surgery on the.
It's even more trivial, almost more trivial than that.
So this one, you can't write in the corner like that. Well, it doesn't matter.
Here I am not supposed to write here. Okay. Well, it doesn't matter. It's elementary anyway. Okay, maybe I'll do my morning exercise then. Maybe I want to send this one. So the proof of the theorem is the following. Just look at W. Union R2n minus Z. So you take R2n, you remove sigma, you get something with remove Z. You get something with boundary sigma, and you plug in W. And the end, you write Meyer-Vietoris, except that instead of say of doing that with R2n, you it's the same R2n or the ball, so you get. This sequence here, HP of R2n minus Z, and goes to HP of sigma. And then, well, there's no need to go back because this is going to be HP plus 1 of R2n, and so this is 0. This is also 0, at least for most values of P. And so here you get that this is an isomorphism. And so first you get that this map here is injective. Okay. And then you get, so this has to be injective. And then you get that BP of sigma is BP of W plus BP of R2n. Minus Z, and this implies by Alexander duality that BP of sigma is BP of W plus B2n minus P minus 1, of Z. So I don't need Z in the theorem, but I need Z. And now what do we have? Well, you can apply the same thing for W equals Z. gives you a filling, and so what you get is that BP of sigma is BP of z plus B to n minus P minus 1 of z, and as a result, BP of z is BP of w. Well, this is actually true for P between 0 and 2n minus 1. You have to deal with the non-zero homology of R2n, but I let you do that as an exercise. Okay. So I must, yeah?
This used Eliashberg Blomek done somewhere. Okay.
Yes, of course. The fact that the last term is R2n. So it's the fact that the union, yes, sorry. So it's not only Meyer-Vietoris.
I would argue that that means it's not elementary.
It's elementary from it's an elementary step starting from a Fleurer Macduff Eliashberg. That's what
Eliashberg
I meant.
Name West?
Because
it's
Yasha.
Because
what?
In his mind, it's Yasha. So he's.
Because it's Yasha. No, I think because the Fleurer Macduff proved that the homology is zero, and then after that, Eliashberg, am I correct? Prove that the pi one is zero.
I mean, we were, yeah.
Is that correct?
I think that's right.
And the paper is actually your paper.
We were talking at MSRI, and I was talking to Andreas, and he had this, and then Yasha came out and said, aha, right.
Okay.
We did it together, right?
So we could say it's elementary mod Yasha's Yaha. Ha-ha.
Well, the rest of it uses sort of geohomology.
Yeah, geohomology curve and moduli spaces. Okay. That's the.
And the fact that the only breaking can come from. Can,
exactly.
Blowing up. Yeah. The condition on relative H2 is what gives you some technically a spherical for a final.
No, what you actually need is that the union that I picture here, so W union R2n minus Z, should be still symplectically aspherical. So this assumption on the H2 implies that. Actually, in the paper with Alex, we have other conditions that imply that. But you need some condition that will guarantee that this manifold is aspherical, and it's not enough that W and the W itself is aspherical. So let me make a number of remarks. One remark, I don't know how much it fits here, but so according to some result by Meilin Yao, if sigma xi is contact and satisfies that the first Chern class of xi is zero and W is time subcritical, then we have that the cylindrical contact homology of sigma and xi is isomorphic to the homology of W relative to sigma tensor, well, basically with the cohomology of CP infinity, I think shifted by 2, but that's. And it's interesting to compare the kind of result that you get. So here what you get is that if you know the cylindrical contact homology of sigma and xi, okay, then you know something. I mean, from this you can extract the homology of W, basically. So you basically know the homology of W, and vice versa, provided you have this Stein subcritical condition. Okay. This kind of statement is different. You get, you ask for an information about the contact structure by saying it can be embedded somewhere. In this case, it's in R2N. And then from that, just the differential or the homology of sigma gives you information about the homology of W. But of course, you can also somehow combine the two and say, well, if, for example, sigma has a contact embedding in R2N, then you're going to know the relative homology of W sigma, and therefore you're going to know something. I mean, if you're in this the situation of the corollary where you have a Stein, a subcritical Stein filling, then you know also the symplectic, the contact, cylindrical contact homology. Okay. But if you look at the two statements somehow separately, they're telling you different things. One starts really from the cylindrical, from the contact structure that you're supposed to know quite well to compute this, and gives you information about this. And the other one, you have a sort of much coarser assumption, okay, by just saying, well, there's a contact embedding somewhere, and then I know the homology and from of sigma, and from this I know the homology of W. Basically, so this, yeah.
This result is for any dimension, right? For the case where n is greater than 2, or
I think 5.
Maybe, I don't know, n is greater than something, at least. I don't. Let me just continue. Oops. On similar questions, and then so another obvious question somehow, well, I mean, the question is obvious, I don't mean the answer, is the following: take L to be a compact manifold, look at the sphere bundle of the cotangent, the sphere cotangent bundle of L with the standard contact form. Mm-hmm. And then the question is, what are the possible fillings of this, of ST star lambda, ST star L with lambda? Of course, the question is, well, at least homologically, should they have the same homology as D? So is it DT star L? Okay. And well, we have the proposition, again, I think N has to be greater than 3, is that if L, which obviously follows from what? If L has a Lagrange embedding in R2N, unfortunately, I didn't say exact Lagrange, so you have non-empty set of examples. W, a filling of S star L lambda, such that the relative homology of W with respect to the boundary is zero, then from what follows, W has the homology. Okay. And you can construct, of course, many of these if you have L, which has an immersion in R2n, then L times S1, for example, has an embedding in R2n plus 2. And the assumption of having an immersion in R2n is just an assumption of the tangent bundle. So if the tangent bundle, the complexified tangent bundle is trivial, then you have such an immersion, for example. So what did I want to say? Okay, so of course it's a bit frustrating if you say that all this comes from one, a well-known theorem, and two, Meyer-Vietoris. Okay. And then you think, well, maybe we can work a little bit more and get some.
Can you use this S1 trick to upgrade a filling of?
No, no, because if you try to multiply by D2, so the problem is that the boundary of DT star this is this term, which is okay, but it contains also this term, which is not okay because it's, I mean, it really comes from the feeling that you had, okay? So yeah, maybe I can. So the idea is, well, let's try to generalize this theorem, the Fleur-McDuff-Eliasberg theorem, and then apply again Meyer-Vietoris, and maybe we get to a wider class of examples. So the theorem is the following. So assume sigma xi admits a contact embedding in a subcritical Stein manifold. Now let W be an aspherical filling such that the relative H2 of W and sigma vanishes, then the map I hope this is correct from HG of W to HG of sigma is injective for all J. Okay. And well, if sigma xi is just S minus 1, S2n minus 1 with the standard sphere, you essentially get, well, you exactly get, well, up to this pi 1 thing, which I must admit we were too lazy to investigate. We get the Fleur-MacDuff-Eliasberg theorem. Of course, S2n minus 1 with the standard structure has a contact embedding in R2n, so in a subcritical style. Okay. And what this says is that if you have an aspherical filling, then the map from Hj of W to Hj of sigma is injective, but this is zero for most values. Okay, so it means that this is zero for basically all values.
Just to understand, subcritical Stein manifold does not mean it somehow is a subset of R2n already?
No.
So what is that?
Subcritical Stein means that, well, implies that it's a product of C by your theorem by Chilibak. Is the product of C and I think a Stein manifold. Okay? And yeah. So in particular, subcritical Stein implies that the symplectic homology, so let's say this one is M omega subcritical Stein, the symplectic homology of M omega, well, the plus part, let's say, and constant part vanishes. Okay. So let me state a corollary of this. If sigma is a rational or just a homology sphere, and if sigma xi embeds in subcritical Stein, then any symplectically aspherical filling will be a rational homology ball. Well, I had plans to describe a little bit the proof, but I think that was overly optimistic.
The clock is fast and we started 5 minutes late, so okay. You have till 40.
I have till 40.
On this clock.
On this clock.
So 15 minutes.
Yes, my says 20. Past. Okay. Okay, then, so I was about to skip many things, so I will just skip half of what I plan to skip. Still, I don't think I want to embark on the idea of the proof.
Can you tell us what the ingredients are?
What the ingredients are?
Yeah.
They're basically the same as, let's say. No, for this, no. So what we use is that, so the first thing is that is a result by Chilibak, which says that subcritical Stein is the product of something which I will denote by M and C. So that's how I start. The second point is resolved by Liska and Matic, which tells me that one can close M to a manifold P. And then the idea is to work in P times S2. And now the idea is essentially the same as the one, but requires more work, in the theorem by Fleur, Macduff, and Eli Ashberg, at looking at rational curves which are in the homology class of S2. Okay. So what actually we do is to replace and then consider V as well, Z was embedded in M times C here, so becomes embedded now in P times S2. So you take P times S2, remove Z, and then you add you glue over sigma your manifold W. Okay. And then you somehow count holomorphic curves, which are, so somehow at infinity, you have the curves in P times S2. You use some analog of hyperplane section to sort of normalize the holomorphic surf by fixing 3 points, okay, so that you don't have to deal with the reparametrization. And then you have also some homological argument, but basically you, by kind of continuation, you can fill the space V by this holomorphic curves.
Yeah, that's okay. Exactly the same idea.
That's exactly the same idea. Exactly. Yeah.
What is Z?
Z is the interior of.
It's on the board.
No, for once it was not on the board. Everybody asked what, in all previous statements there was a Z, and since you complained, I dropped it. But now you see it's useful. So it embeds in a subset in a subcritical Stein, and the interior is Z. So here you could say with interior component equal to Z. Okay.
But in the outflow case, you have like a choice of which thing to make your S2. And here you
here you have no choice on which thing to make to S2, but I mean that's not so different. And then the sort of homological argument in the end is slightly different, but basically the ideas are essentially the same.
So is it an assumption that there is an interior and just being completely sigma?
Sorry?
Why is there an interior? Is it an assumption?
It says no, because if it's subcritical Stein, H to n minus 1 is 0, and then by Alexander duality, the hypersurface will have an inside and an outside. So it follows from the hypothesis here. So there are two more things I wanted to discuss about the problem, about this kind of problem. The first one are symplectic let's say, symplectic homology. Obstructions. Because there's a sort of starting point which uses rational curves, okay, in the symplectic manifold, but apart from that, it's all ordinary homology somehow. I mean, there's no Fleur homology. There's a hidden Gromov-Witten invariant, okay, but there's not much apart from that. So what can we say if we use more about symplectic homology? Well, there was the statement I quoted before by Meilin Yao, but let me say a few more things. So I will say, actually, I don't know what this, that W omega is. Well, I would like to say Fleur as spherical, but if it satisfies that the symplectic homology of W vanishes. I thought of symplectically, not as spherical, sorry, I meant acyclic. I don't know if there's a, yes. P is the manifold you get from M, which was probably, so you start from the subcritical Stein. Okay. You write it as M times C. So in the original situation of Fleur, Macduff, and Eliasberg, the subcritical Stein is just R to N. So it's easy to write it as a product of something and C. So it's going to be Cn minus 1 times C. And then the Cn minus 1, you close it as a compact symplectic manifold. And this is P. Okay. And so in the original paper, it's closed as a torus. Okay. As a torus, as a product of spheres. Okay. But it doesn't matter what you close it as. And then you have that sigma is embedded. Of course, it was embedded in M times C, so it's embedded in P times S2. And then you make surgery over P times S2 by removing this Z, which is the interior, and gluing W instead, and see what you get from there by looking at holomorphic curves. Okay.
Do you know such a manifold without a C factor?
What, subcritical Stein?
No, I mean a Fleury cyclic manifold, which is not something plus C.
So every flexible Weinstein domain is Fleury cyclic, but they're not all subcritical. So subcritical is equivalent to this product.
Subcritical is equivalent to the product by Chilibach's theorem. And okay, thanks. So let me state a proposition here. So let sigma xi bound a subcritical Stein W omega, let M omega be Fleur acyclic, and sigma be embedded in such a way that you have a separating embedding. and sigma. Be separating in M. With interior Z, and then the homology are the same. The homology of Z is the same as the homology of W. Okay. And well, if you want to know the ingredients, well, there's the result by MacLean, which says that when you are embedded, where you have an exact embedding in Fleur acyclic, you're again Fleur acyclic. There's the, you use the long exact sequence in symplectic homology. And then you use a result by Bourgeois by Bourgeois and Wanchia, which says that sigma xi determines the positive part of W under some assumptions. You need that there are no Kohn-Lesender orbits on the boundary of index, I think, less than 3 minus n. And you can prove that it's satisfied here if sigma bounds a subcritical Stein. Okay. And so the last thing I wanted to say are applications, which maybe in a way is most fun. And also maybe asks, so somewhere here, what's hidden is the idea that you, if you have a cobordism, so if you have a contact manifold which is concave on one side and another which is convex on the other side, one of them is more complicated than the other. Okay. There should be sort of increasing complexity in this way. And so there are sort of obvious questions that come up about complex singularities. So for example, let's F be a complex polynomial and zero be an isolated singularity. Then you can look at this singular hypersurface here, you can look at the intersection with a small sphere, okay. And this is actually, well, here it's going to be, let's say, plus, so a complex polynomial on Cn plus 1, so that this now is in S to n minus 1. This has a contact structure by taking the maximal complex subspaces here. And there's something which is called a symplectic manifold, which is the Milner fiber, here, which essentially you get by, instead of looking at F minus 1 of 0, you just move a little bit. So you have your singularity here. You have a sphere here. Well, you would like to look at this filling here, but you don't. You actually look at something which is just below here. And so W will just be this. So this is, this thing here is W. Okay. So W is a symplectic manifolds that bounds sigma, and W is a wedge of spheres, and it's a wedge of mu spheres, and mu is the Milner number. And so here the idea is that the biggest mu, the more complicated singularity you have. I mean, if you have no singularity, actually mu is equal to 2. Okay. And so the proposition I would like to state is the following, and then I'm through. So again, for n greater than 3, sorry. So sigma psi is called the link of a singularity such that the intersection form on W is non-zero, then sigma psi has no embedding, so no contact embedding, of course, in a subcritical stan. And the second theorem is that if you're looking at Briscoe manifolds, and mu is at least equal to 2, there are no subcritical, for example, Stein embeddings. Okay. And the idea is that, I mean, this is somehow the result for mu equal 1. It says that if you have a trivial singularity, okay, then W is essentially Cn, and so you cannot have a larger singularity, so something which with a larger mu, with some assumption here, that will embed, of course, in Cn. What you would like to say is that if you look at two singularity with mu strictly less than mu prime, and you take the manifolds W corresponding to mu and to mu prime, you cannot embed the more complicated one into the simplest one. That's what we'd like to know, but I have absolutely no idea on how to...
And can you rewrite the statement if you'd like to know?
Well, if you have sigma 1 W1 with mu 1, sigma 2 W2 with mu 2, so this one comes with psi 1, and this comes with omega 1, this comes with psi 2, and this one with omega 2. And then you would say that something like there's no contact embedding or exact contact embedding, I don't know. Of sigma 2, psi 2 in W1, omega 1, if mu 1 is less than mu 2. So in this sense, sigma 2 is more complicated than sigma 1.
If one of them degenerates into the other one? Then you have a cuboid as a...
No. No, the only thing I know is this, so with this extra assumption about the intersection. And it's essentially the trivial case. I mean, it says you cannot embed in a subcritical stan. Okay, my time is more than up now. Thank you very much for your attention.